Right, let's go on to something a bit deeper now, a bit more mathsy. The first one is very much a physics, electrical engineering kind of world. We have for quite a while now had a really decent partial differential equation, finite element system for being able to model physical things like electromagnetism. And in more recent years, we've been adding a layer of language on top of that that allows you to talk about physical and multiphysics problems at a high level rather than having to get down into crafting the correct PDE representation. And that's grown a little bit further. The new thing here is electric current PDE component. And the idea is here that we're modeling electrical currents flowing through materials. So I've got some geometry represented using our geometry framework. So that could have been imported from a STL file or from a CAD package. I'm using our entities to say, prescribe the materials of that, say it's tungsten. So some of these things depend on properties like conductivity. And by telling it tungsten, it can look up all of those values. And then we set up some boundary conditions, electricity flowing in at one end and out the other. And then we're solving it and visualizing the current density on the thing. And you get here from our slice plot 3D, we can see now that we get really constant current in the straight lines. But as it goes around corners, you get a stronger, greater current density on the inside of the curve that the electricity is kind of trying to shortcut around. And so you get some unevenness in the density. But all of that is basically the solution to a PDE behind the scenes. Getting a little bit more into the ODE world, we've been able to compute all kinds of ODE type and delay differential equations, all these kinds of differential equations, but we're now trying to move into more interesting properties of those. So if you consider this flow that's going on here, that perhaps this is some kind of electromagnetic field or it's a fluid flow or something, you can imagine here that if I released some point, some particle into this flow at -1, then it would, as time progresses, as we move right, it would flow down until it reached -3 and then it would stop. So if we inject something at exactly -3 or exactly zero, then we're at a fixed point within that differential equation. Finding those fixed points is now covered within the system. So I can say the fixed points of the differential equation that represents that flow, and we get the two fixed point values for the inputs of -3 and zero. But also, if you look at the plot here, they're slightly different. If we were slightly away from -3, we would flow back towards it. If we're slightly away from zero, we flow away from it. So one of these is stable and the other one is unstable. And we also have the ability to do that as well. So we can find both the fixed points, but we can also attach to them their stability. That the -3 is the stable solution and zero is a fixed point, but it's an unstable one. So any perturbation and you're going to travel away from it. Now, the next one is getting a little bit more theoretical, and this is possibly one of the most asked for features on this list, that we've had a great framework for being able to work with matrices and arrays, all kinds of functionality, and we've been able to work with matrices and arrays with symbolic entries. So I can have a matrix A, B, C, D and say what's the determinants of that matrix, or you know the eigenvalues of that matrix, and it's quite happy with those symbolic values. But we've never had a representation of the matrix itself as a symbolic value. We've always had to populate the matrix and then work with those symbols. And that's both computationally much more demanding, but it also ends up with solutions that are basically unusable, that they are, might be technically correct, but they're not in a form that you can make use of. So now, for the first time, we're introducing a matrix symbol that allows me to declare a symbol M as being a matrix that is, in this case, 7x7 in size. And it doesn't do anything. It's just a symbolic wrapper to allow me to say this thing is a 7x7 matrix. And this also works for arbitrary arrays as well. So it could be 7x7x7x7. But now that we've declared that, all of these functions in the list above can now work with those symbolic objects. So, for example, if I ask for the derivative or the third derivative of the matrix of the determinant of M with respect to the matrix M, then we can get that out in terms of that matrix. And we've got some kind of rich tensor notation here for things where there are calculations according to the indices of the tensor. But we've got a kind of high level symbolic representation of those operations. So this is useful if you're doing things like stability type calculations of working a system through a set of steps and be able to understand what would perturbations on that be, or some of these things we could then, as the final step, normalize them to turn them back into actual matrices of numbers or symbols and pick out individual elements as a final step, not as a working step. A very minor bit of syntax. This is the symbolic notation we've had for a long time for solving differential equations, where we've got the derivative of y as a function of t, but very often in textbooks, the kind of time parameterization of the differential equation is omitted as sort of just implied, and we now have the ability to accept that notation.